Yeah, you could. You're close enough. Yeah. Okay, that's probably better. And the other thing is, now that I'm socially distanced, we'll do this. I do ask, though, that we keep our masks during the service. You will have an impulse to sing. I know you will. And that, of course, as we've learned, sort of projects this thing even further yet. So please, as uncomfortable as they are, and they fog my glasses up something fierce, please do keep your masks on. And welcome to an Easter service. Now, isn't this the funniest Easter you ever been to? But we've got the He is Risen and the white paraments and lots of flowers today. We've got Easter hymns here and an Easter set of scriptures. And so we missed the calendar Easter, and here we are, and we recognize today, you bet, He is risen. Okay, thank you. All right, good. A couple of things. Communion, going to be a little different. It's called continuous communion. If you're a pundit, you might call it drive-by. So you're going to go out that side. Yep. Going to come past here, both elements, throw the cup, and go back up this way. At the same time as that's happening, then, this one here, you're going to come out this side, you're going to go past this and back in on that side. One and one, and then two and two, right? Choreography for communion. What a deal. And all it took was a virus. All right. Remember to continue to sign up for services using the electronic system that Holly Gast has designed, or you can call in. Some of you may not have internet connection. You can also call in. We're going to continue to do that. And through the month of July, we're going to continue to do three services, one Saturday and two on Sunday, just to kind of see. If Sunday looks like this, we'll go down to one, but that won't matter to you. You are the faithful Saturday nighters. At the end of the service, the nurse could use a couple of hands. What we're going to do is to disinfect backs of the pews with Clorox wipes. We're going to do the handles in the bathrooms and the exits. You'll notice that the doors were open. They will be open again as you leave. And as Byron plays, and Byron, of course, is in his last couple of weeks of being our organist. Fine, go. As Byron plays our closing hymn, we're going to dismiss from the back, pew by pew, so that there isn't a knot of people in the aisle. Okay, understand? The ushers will be dismissing us that way. So you'll be the last one out. Don't that figure? Yeah, okay. I think that's all I've got. We're going to start with, I know that my Redeemer lives. This was written by Samuel Medley. He was born in 1738 in the UK, and he was apprenticed before his parents were killed at an early age. He was apprenticed as an oilman in London and hated it. So he joined the Navy as a kid. And he was terribly injured in a naval battle. And at 21, had to leave the Navy. Almost lost the leg that was wounded. But in a miracle that the ship's surgeon, which is sort of a jokey name in the 18th century, the ship's surgeon said he'd never seen anything like it. He knew the night before that he was going to take Medley's leg off the next day, and by some miracle, he did not have to do that. And it wasn't until he was 28 or 30 that Medley listened to a sermon written by Isaac Watts, read by his grandfather to him as he was living with his grandfather, that he had a religious conversion, and he was, for the rest of his life, he died at 61, the rest of his life, he was a Baptist preacher ever after, and a very successful one in a couple of places in the UK. This is a hymn we all know. Let's rise and you know about this singing. Thank you. Mike.
Let us go before our Heavenly Father in a time of confession. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Word and by Christ's very authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Go in peace. Amen. Pray. Almighty God, by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light. Grant that we who have been raised with him may abide in his presence and rejoice in the hope of eternal glory. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our first reading for today is found in the book of Acts, the 10th chapter, beginning with the 34th verse. So Peter opens his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee, after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people, to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Samuel Medley, on his deathbed, and it was a painful one, spoke these words at the very end: "I am now a shattered bark about to gain the blissful harbor, and oh, how sweet that will be after the storm." I feel a little that way about being here today, after, during the storm we're all enduring. Boy. And in the Acts reading that he just gave you, Peter's been called on the carpet when he got back to Jerusalem after some activities in Joppa and at Caesarea. It's a wonderful story. If you don't know it, read the first 33 verses of Acts 10, and it'll explain why Peter is having to explain himself. Let's rise for the reading of the gospel from the 28th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. "Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, 'Departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. And Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And now together we confess the Apostles' Creed, those short sentences of the things we share in belief in the Christian faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
How about that? Appreciate your help. Because this isn't natural to us for some reason. We haven't been doing this. I forget how to work this stuff, for heaven's sakes. Well, looking for something. And I'm not sure he knows how to work those binoculars. I mean, he's not yet three, but he does know you look through one end and something is in the other end. But it's a little like, although he's a lot slimmer in the midsection, but he's a lot like a lot of us. We're looking for something, aren't we? And in a time like this, we're looking for reassurance. What does all this mean? Does God really have a plan? Why is he allowed this? What does all this mean to us? And especially, what on an Easter does it mean that he chose to rise and to be among people in such a dramatic way? Walking into that upper room finally after, that Sunday evening, walking in, and they were frightened, of course, by his appearance. And he said, hey, look, it's me. It really is me. And I am alive in all the ways you remember. He was seen by so many on Easter and for the 40 days that followed. And when you read Paul's account of this at the end of 1 Corinthians, he appeared, of course, to those two on the road and then to the disciples who were gathered in that upper room, and then to so many others, to 500 at once. And Paul says, many of those are still alive and are witnesses to having seen the risen Christ, although he says in Corinthians, but some of them have fallen asleep, some were dead by that time. He appeared, of course, and this is one of my favorites, and you've heard this before, that he appeared to his half-brother James and totally changed James' life in that moment. And when you read Acts 10, you'll notice that Peter gets called up in front of James, who was then kind of the head of the council at Jerusalem. And so James was then martyred. But Jesus appeared to so many, and why would he do that? And he, of course, he did it that all of us would know that he told the truth when he said, I am. He said, I am, in so many different ways. In John, what are there, seven ways? And when the high priest, right before he was killed, asked him, are you really, the high priest said, are you the Son of God? And he said, I am, and caused the high priest, regardless of what Joel says in Scripture, don't tear your garments, rend your soul. The high priest tore his garment. That's such an outrage, that someone might proclaim himself the Son of God. Why would Jesus show himself in such a way? Why? So that we would all know, they then, we now, so much later, would know the truth. This is God's Son. Come to this earth, he was fully God, yet fully man, and there's a whole lot of scriptural teaching about that combination, and yet it was God himself come to this earth, taking into himself mankind. Well, he appeared in so many ways that all would know that he truly is the way. And what did he say about that? I am the way and the truth and the life. And no one comes to the Father. And after all, isn't that our goal? To be with the Father, the Creator in heaven, as Scripture describes it. Isn't that our goal as Christian people? And Jesus affirms that he is, and he is still, the way and the truth and the life. He came to so many that they would all know the Trinity, that we would recognize that God is one, and yet God is in three persons. Try to explain that to a non-Christian who hasn't been taught some. And yet we recognize that the Lord God comes to us in so many different ways. He is Creator God. He, after all, he did this universe and knit us together in this fantastic way. We do have a shelf life. We do wear out. But the human body is an amazing thing, a creation of the Lord's. And the evolutionists might try to tell you differently, that after all, you evolved from a one-cell system. But I think the story we're given in Scripture, that we are created by God and life was breathed into us, that's the one I hold to. And you know what else? You as a Christian, you don't have to explain the gulf between what science says and what Scripture says. You don't have to explain that to anybody. You can simply say, this is what I believe. And oh, by the way, what you believe is not proven. It's maybe not even a theory. It's a proposal, evolution I'm talking about. Don't tell your kids I said that. They'll all be mad at me. So there's the Creator God, and that is one of the persons in which we experience God himself and this Trinity. And then there is Jesus himself, who came to this earth, who lived, who taught, who sacrificed himself for us to bear the penalty of sin that we ought to bear, into death, and then raised by God into life again. He taught, he spoke, and people wrote it down. And we have it. And you know, I was just talking to somebody the other day who holds Scripture as a series of ethical lessons. Make no mistake, Jesus taught this. He taught how we ought to live with each other, right, in this kingdom, and also how we ought to live before God in that kingdom. He did do that. There is an ethical system that he set out. It has to do with those commandment-y things. But beyond that, there is salvation that he came to proclaim and to obtain for us on the cross and from the grave. And then there is Holy Spirit, and all need to know this, that as a Christian in your baptism, unless you have rejected it since, that you were given the seed of something called faith and the opportunity to allow that faith to grow in your heart, not as one who is separated from the church or from Scripture or from Christian friends, but one who participates in these things, who enjoys the sanctification involved in learning about who this Jesus is and what he had to say and what our future is. He came and showed himself that we might all know the Trinity. Not know it here, but know it here. That all would know that a faithful future is assured. Jesus came, risen from the dead, as example of what it will be for us, as baptized Christians who believe, who are willing to come in an unusual and maybe for some uncomfortable way, come to his table tonight, that we recognize that our future is assured, that our life in eternity was gained for us by him. What a wonderful example, that he would come back from the dead, rise from the tomb, a terrible earthquake which so frightened the guards that were placed there that they pretended that they were all dead, and the stone was rolled aside and there was the angel. It doesn't matter which of the explanations in Scripture you read about those moments when that was discovered. Read them all. They each add something different, don't they? But those that experienced that moment, wow. And those that experienced him as a living being again, and we who experience him as a living being through this communion, through the sacrament of baptism, through worshiping together in our tens and not in our hundreds, it doesn't matter. We recognize that life come back to is example for us. That future is assured of life in eternity. And that all would know that his plan will hold through thick and thin, virus or no. God is in heaven. Jesus has a plan. Now, I don't know what this is all about. I just shudder to think that the devil is grinning, that churches are shut down, that we haven't seen each other for 15 weeks or something, except electronically. Don't we look good up here on the TV? And by the way, we do have new equipment that is on order, new cameras and recording equipment that will take it from a fuzzy kind of 1959 looking image into something that's worthy of 2020. And that should be sometime in August. We will not stop recording services because we recognize that part of God's plan, apparently, is that we will be both gathered and scattered, right? And he's given us the opportunity to continue to proclaim God's word, even in a scattered Christian world. Yeah, his plan. I cannot explain the purposes that God has for this virus. But then, neither can I explain that some of us get sick, that some of us fail in our bodies, that some of us fail in our minds, that relationships fall apart. I can't explain that either, except to say that it comes from the garden. There is such a thing as original sin. And you and I are participants in original sin. And oh, by the way, we're very creative in our own paths of sin, are we not? And because of the existence of sin and death and the devil in this world, our bodies will wear out. And I can't explain why some, when the cancer comes, I can't explain it. I can't explain it when relationships fall apart as they do. I can't explain why people's finances after working a whole life collapse. I don't know. Sin, death, and the devil are present. And yet so is God our Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and this is proof of it. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you for being here this afternoon. You know, it's like 116 degrees out there.
Yes.
What if you lived here with no air conditioning? You wouldn't live here. You'd all go back to Wisconsin, wouldn't you? You know, I want to thank the nurse and Raleigh and others who have worked hard to have us prepare for this stuff. You will notice the elders who are distributing communion and the pastors will be bathing in this stuff. And there's X's on the pews and all of that in order to keep us separate, and that doesn't happen without effort from some people. Likewise, we could just use a couple of hands to help clean up just a little bit. You know, with three or four of us, maybe it'll take 10 or 12 minutes after the service. And so thank you to all of you who came here. I'm reassured to see you. And actually, I recognize you, even though you got a mask on. I know who you are. So thank you so much for being here. We just give thanks to God that we can gather once again in this way. In his name.
On the plates, but they are in the narthex as you leave for your offerings. As we go to our Heavenly Father in prayer, we're reminded of those that are listed in the worship service folder. A couple of updates. Jan Barton, diagnosed with COVID. Marlene Peterson will have shoulder surgery on Wednesday. And Amara Mainhart, that's Marlene Peterson's granddaughter, has cancer of the esophagus. We go to our Heavenly Father in a time of prayer. Holy Lord, mighty God, you are the strength of the hills and the hope of the ends of the earth. Give to our hearts your perfect peace, that we may not be anxious nor live in fear, but rest all our hopes, dreams, and desires upon your merciful goodness. Holy God, mighty Lord, you know how weak and frail we are. Give to those afflicted in mind, body, or soul the fullness of your healing grace, that according to your will they may be restored to health. Hear us for all those suffering or recovering from the pandemic ravages, for those who have requested our prayers, and for those whom we name in our hearts. Holy God, mighty Lord, your word endures forever. Keep us from being tossed about by every wind of change and chance, and help us to endure upon the firm foundation of your word and sacraments. Prepare us so that we may worthily receive the Lord's body and blood, and be kept by this blessed communion toward the day when we shall be reunited with all who have gone before and dwell in your presence forevermore. In him, with him, and through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, both now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, also after he supped, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. For this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We rise as together we pray that family prayer that our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.